I guess you all are going to have to listen to me after all. But it's so good to see you all here this morning. It is a wonderful day full of wonderful rain. It is nice. Anyway, I wanted to just refer to the fact that we are thankful, very grateful for the altar flowers given this morning. In loving memory of Bob Murphy for his birthday on October 30th by his wife, Mary, and children. We also celebrate the birth of Charlotte Ray Huffer with the lighting of a candle. And when the acolyte comes forward, you'll see that the extra candle will be lit. Charlotte was born October 12th and is the daughter of Donovan and Sarah Huffer, granddaughter of Mike. Cindy Allen, and the great-granddaughter of the late Ray and Ancy York. Also, I want to call to your attention the blue insert that's in your bulletin. It's regarding our partnership with Prairiemont Elementary School. Some of you responded last Sunday, and that is greatly appreciated. There are still some opportunities, however, and you can help out with that if you haven't volunteered already. So please take time to look over the list of possibilities, and anything that you might be interested in, just mark it and then place it in the offering plate when it comes around. Also, you might want to know that Bobby Johnson has been moved from Baptist Hospital to Lynchburg General. Are there any other announcements this morning? Gee, you're all so quiet. All right. Well, let us continue then as we prepare ourselves for a morning of worship. Thank you.
affirmation from 1 Timothy 2, 5-6, 115, 316. There is one God, and there is one mediator, Christ Jesus, who came as a ransom for all, to whom we testify.
This saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, and was manifested in the flesh, vindicated in the spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed in throughout the world, taken up in glory. Great indeed is the mystery of the gospel. Amen.
Please be seated. The scripture readings from Romans 8, 31 to 39. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height or depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is Christ Jesus our Lord.
Thank you.
The second scripture reading is from John 4, verses 3 through 30, found on page 90 in your pew Bible. So he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" For Jews do not associate with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asked you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go, call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is that you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is Spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the Spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I, the one speaking to you, I am he." Just then, his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, "What do you want?" Or, "Why are you talking with her?" Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, "Come, see, a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah?" They came out of the town and made their way toward him. The word of God for the people of God.
This is the day.
the brightest and the happiest day of your life? What was it? What would you say it was? I mean, can you think what it would be? Maybe a birthday or a particular Christmas or something happened that just sort of changed your life? Well, let's look at one of the experiences of the Bible that we heard this morning about the woman at the city well. I mean, it was her brightest day, but it sure did not start out that way. Now, we really don't know her name, so we'll just go ahead and call her Mara. That name means bitter. That was the way she felt almost about every day in her life. Bitter towards the women of her village, the way that they avoided her. Bitter towards the men of her own town for the way that they treated her and the way they talked about her. Bitter towards herself for the mess she had made of her life. Well, on this particular day that the scripture has opened up for us, she did not want to see anyone. That's it. And that's why she waited until noon to go down to the well with her pitcher, to get the supply of water that she needed for the rest of the day. I mean, there was only one well in Sychar, the village where she lived. And all the other women went to the well early in the morning while it was still cool. For Mara, the one advantage of going in the heat of the day was that no one else would be there. Or so she thought. On this day, she was wrong. When she arrived, she discovered a man sitting beside the well. She hesitated for a moment, wishing that he was not there. But then she was relieved when she realized that he was a stranger. At least he would not know her past and would not treat her with scorn like most of the men in her village did. So she went on ahead and focused on her task. So she set the pitcher down. She prepared the bucket to drop into the well, and the stranger spoke to her politely and asked if she would give him a drink. And he spoke immediately. She recognized that he was a Jew. And she herself, she was a Samaritan. And Jews did not get along with Samaritans. And that's to put it mildly. But they did have serious religious differences that sort of kept them apart. Usually, though, the Jews did not speak with Samaritans. So Mara was amazed that this Jewish stranger should ask her for a drink of water. How is it that you, a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink? But she was even more amazed by Jesus' answer. If you only knew the gift that God has for you and who I am, you would not be asking me for a drink of living water. Oh, but sir, This is a deep well, and you don't have either a rope or a bucket. Where would you get that living water? So then that Jesus went ahead and explained that the water that he was able to give was far better than the water that comes from the earth. It is the water of eternal life, he said. And it becomes like an ever-flowing spring within a person. And everyone who drinks of it never is thirsty again. Well, those words made Mara sort of eager to taste it. Oh, well, please, sir, give me some of that water. Then I won't have to make this long walk down here to the well. Go get your husband and return here, Jesus instructed. But I don't have a husband. Her voice was really troubled. Oh, that is true in a way, Jesus answered. But you have had five husbands, and you're not married to the man you live with now. Mara was silent for a moment. I mean, she was so ashamed. So much so that she really didn't know what to say. I mean, how did this stranger know the mess that she had made of her life? So she decided to change the subject. You seem to be a prophet, she said. I mean, so tell me, why do Jews teach that the temple in Jerusalem is the only place to worship God, and we Samaritans believe that the mountain where our temple stood before it was destroyed 100 years ago is also a holy place? Well, it's not where we worship, how we worship that counts with God, was Jesus' answer. It's not the place that matters, but it's the spirit in which we worship. Mara replied, I know that when the Messiah comes, and I believe in my whole heart that he is coming, he will explain everything that we do not understand. He has already come, Jesus said. I am the Messiah. Well, Mara's face just sort of lit up with amazement. Now she understood why this man had treated her with such kindness. I mean, real kindness. And how he knew everything about her past. Well, right then, Jesus' disciples arrived. They'd been down at the village to buy the food, but Mara hardly noticed them. Not bothered to even pick up her water jar. She hurried back to the village to tell the people about this man and what he had said to her. And when the people of the village heard the news, well, they followed Mara back to the well. And as they visited with Jesus, they were so impressed that they forgot all about the prejudice between Jews and Samaritans. And they invited him and his disciples to stay in the village as guests. And Jesus and his disciples accepted them, and they stayed for 2 whole days. And after that, the other villagers said to Mara, "At first we believed because of what you said about him. But now that we have listened to him, we know for sure that he is the Messiah, the Savior of the world." Well, Mara knew it too. And though her name did not change, she did. No longer could it be said that life was bitter, because of all the people in Sychar, she was the happiest. Not only had she met her Savior, but she now understood what he meant when he spoke about giving her the water of eternal life to drink. I mean, it seemed almost too good to be true, but it is the truth. The barriers she had with other people of her village, the barriers between her people and those from the other side of the borders, was washed clean. The living water of Jesus brings new meaning to the lives we live. The living water brings joy to our lives, purpose to our lives, a whole new perspective of life. How about you? Do you know? Do you know? Do you know of the living water of which Jesus speaks? We want to include those that are beyond our fellowship who are in need of your comforting presence, those who have may have individually shared with you, people that of our family, people of friends and neighbors. May they know the gift of peace that you offer your people. So in your mercy, lift up to you, Lord, the people of our nation and the peoples of the world who seem so concentrated on caustic words and actions in opposition to others, opposition because of revenge, of racial differences, of extreme political bias. We pray for those who are so overcome by prejudice that they have lost their perspective, that those other people in their lives are brothers and sisters of the human race. In your mercy, we lift up those who are searching for purpose, for direction, for friends, for other persons with whom they can share their concerns and worries. We share with those who have lost relationships upon which they were able to share the concerns of daily living, those who need introduction or renewal of relationship with you. In your mercy, we lift up with thanksgiving those who are valued in our relationships, for those with whom we are blessed to have valued relationships, for friends and family with whom we share enjoyable experiences, for those for whom we are so very thankful. Bless each and every one of them. In your mercy,
Lord, hear our prayer.
We are so thankful for the blessing of rain. It symbolizes for us that you are the source of life. Rain provides some of the essentials of all living things and even refreshes the air we breathe. We are so thankful to you for rain. In your mercy, these things we share with you, Lord, you have certainly blessed us, especially in your gift of sharing with us your Son, who shared so lovingly your words of life and love and grace. He who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us sing, Lord, speak to me.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord, speak to us, that we may speak in living echoes of your word. Oh, teach us, Lord, that we may teach the precious things you have shared with us. Oh, fill us with your fullness, Lord, until our very hearts overflow in kind thoughts and glowing words. Oh, use us, Lord. Use each of us just as you will, and when and where. Amen. So let's prepare to go. Listen for the Lord. Prepare to do what the Lord may ask of you. And let your hearts just sing praise.